First off, I want to thank you for this opportunity. I don't know, I've got to take it out of my mouth tonight. This is kind of what I'm speaking about, not that God stretch you a little bit. I want to speak it out tonight, because I'm very Christians and coming of age. What I'm talking about tonight is not, this is for everyone, including myself. Now, bear with us, I'm going chasing rabbits. Hopefully I catch one of them.
Amen.
Sun Tzu was a legendary military strategist in ancient China, and he was the author of a famous book called The Art of War. He was a master of soft power and a father of agile warfare. Whenever possible, he preferred to win without fighting, or at the very least, to win the easiest battles first. He wrote, "In war, the victorious strategist only seeks battle after the victory has already been won." He advises troops to make your way through unexpected routes and attack unguarded spots. He further stated, "Military tactics are like war. For in the natural course of war, it runs from the high places and it hastens down to the low places. So in war, the way to avoid, you avoid what is strong and strike what is weak." So, the questions must be asked. If Satan knows my weak points, and he knows all of my weak points, how do I protect myself from his attack? Do I know enough about him to know his weak points and how to exploit them? Church, I don't give any props to the devil, but don't be fooled and don't be naive. Satan is a powerful enemy, and he is a master at war strategy. He's been doing this for a very long time. Believe it or not, Satan has studied your life, your strengths, your weaknesses, since you took your first breath. Why does he do that? Because each and every one of you are a potential threat to his kingdom.
Right.
Satan knows what gets under your skin.
Yeah.
He knows what hurts you. He knows what you like. He knows what you love. He knows what you hate. He knows what stirs your emotions and affections.
Right.
And you can rest assured of one thing. He will exploit each and every one of those avenues to destroy you and your family.
Amen.
Amen.
I want you to understand something. You and I are no match for Satan in our own wisdom, our own strength, or our own power. If you try to battle Satan using your five senses, or in other words, with his flesh, you will lose every time. But with God, Satan is no match for us. Understand what I just said. With God, he's no match for us.
Amen.
We must war and use the tools God has given us to use. Those tools are almighty through God to be pulling down the strongholds. God's word tells us, "Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world." Another place in scripture says, "I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven."
Yes.
It says, "Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and on scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you." Praise the Lord. That's the promises from God.
Yes.
He gives us great power. He gives great authority.
Yes.
But just a minute. Those verses I just read to you, they are not just automatically applied to your life. You can't go half-hearted with God and expect him to entrust to you all of his battle armor. It would be like handing over a double-barrel shotgun to a small child. They know nothing about the danger and the power it possesses. They are unskillful in the use and the operation of that weapon. And if handled wrong, it can bring great harm or even death to the user. But if handled correctly, it can protect and even help feed the family. promised you. You will have to obtain it God's way.
Amen.
That's right, church. If you want God's, what God has afforded you, you can only claim it His way.
That's right.
And how do we start that? First off, Hebrews tells us, we all know this verse, but without faith, it is impossible to please Him. For he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. That scripture says, first and foremost, we have to believe in God with all we are. Then we have to diligently seek Him. We can't just come in here and get it out around. We have to, not just here, at home and out in our lives. The Hebrews says, of whom we have many things to say, and are hard to be uttered, seeing that you are dull of hearing. So when the time you ought to be teachers, you have need that will teach you again, which is the first principle of the oracle of God, and are become the one you have become, such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For everyone that uses milk is unskillful, is that word again, unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. The strong meat belongeth to them who are of full age. They have matured. Even those by reason of use have exercised their senses to discern both good and evil. But I'm telling you, you must take what God has given you and exercise it. You can't just let it lay dormant. I can go buy a compound bow, and everybody knows it. And I could be not familiar with it. I can go out there and pull that bow back and let it go. I've seen it and put it up on your arm that you ain't never believe.
Yeah.
You can let it go this way, let it go that way. I've seen it impale people's hands. You can take a gun and do the same thing, give somebody that's not familiar with it. They don't know how to hold it. They don't know how to trigger for it. They don't know how to breathe. It can be dangerous too in the wrong hands.
Amen.
So here's what a problem is. This skill comes from many years of practice. And I'm telling you, don't be afraid to use what God has given you. I've heard of people say, I'm afraid of this. And don't be afraid to use
it. Yes, come on.
Because through trial and error, you're going to make mistakes.
That's right.
But that's where you learn from. All these other things I just spoke about, that's where you learn to hone your skill. The same way we've got in spiritual life. You have to take the Spirit and use it the way God says you do. Oh, you don't know nothing about some people say, I don't hear God. You never exercise your ears to hear.
That's right. Come on, brother.
What am I saying? Warriors, they don't drink milk. They eat meat. They train and prepare, sharpening their skills to be ready for any confrontation. It's time for some of us to put the bottle down.
If
they gird up the loins of our mind and become a full age. Another way of saying this is, you need to grow up. Clearly, all of us is in that boat. But it's time to start exercising the gifts that God has given us. They have laid dormant for too long. We have watched as the enemy has walked into our camp and took what he wanted. He's caused sickness in our homes. He's caused depression. He's attacked our children. Our spouses and we have sat there in the corner, sucking our bottles, shaking like a leaf. What do I do now? Where is the warrior that God intended you to be? It's time to rise up, church, and fight against the lies of the devil.
That's right.
Jesus told us he gives us those armor. With faith, we can block and fight those things.
Yes.
You can say, I believe all you want. But until you are really convinced and have a made up mind about this gospel, you're like a caged lion. You have a lot of noise and a lot of potential power, but you're no good to nobody. When you're really convinced that God is for you and has your back, your life will reflect what you believe.
That's right.
You will see God manifest His power through you. You will love what God loves. You will hate what God hates. And your prayer life will change, and your home will grow. Your affections will be to God first.
Yes.
You will study. You will study and feed from God's holy word daily. You will let His life consume your life.
Yes.
Your desires will be to heal. Then you'll be able to walk on your knees and take back what the devil has taken from you. Jesus told his disciples, he said, if any man come after me, he must first deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. We're so busy in this life that we forget some of these things. We live here and forget a bunch of this stuff. He said, but whosoever shall save his life, you attempt to save your life outside of God, but you're all intellect, you're going to lose your life. But whosoever will lose his life for my sake, he shall gain. Yes. What would it profit a man to gain this whole world? Gain the whole world and lose his soul. What shall a man give in exchange for his soul? I plead with the church. Never stop. Never back down. Fight despite of fight.
Come on.
You may be the only connection that your family will ever have to the kingdom of God.
Amen.
So I ask you, is your family worth fighting for?
Yes.
Remember, you are not alone. God is with you and will help you. But it must be on his terms, not yours. Without the Lord, there is no life. There is no hope. There is only heartache and anguish. Why not live for him? There is nothing to lose and everything to gain.
Amen.
Church, there's a few things that just don't go together. All and more than we wish. Light and darkness. Good and evil. Faith and fear don't go together. Understand this, that fear is the faith of Satan. I'm going to say that again. Fear is the faith of Satan. Satan feeds on your fear. What am I saying? I'm saying have faith in God. Not in yourself, not in your abilities. Light expels darkness. God is light. If you really put your life and trust in God's hands, the love of God will cast out your fear. But if you try to war on your own, on Satan's level, you're going to fail every time. You can't do it without God. Psalms 61:11. Since hear my cry, O God, attend unto my prayers. From the ends of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to that rock which is higher than I.
Yeah.
For thou hast been a shelter for me and a strong tower for my enemy. I will abide in thy tabernacle forever. I will trust in the covenant of thy word. The only one that you need to fear is the Lord. Because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The scripture says, he that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. He didn't say it would trickle. He said it would flow.
Yes, that's
right. And other people can see it. Your body is supposed to be the temple of the living God. You're not your own. You're bought at a price. Your body should be like a conduit or a channel for the conveying of the power, the purpose, and the will of God. It's like a mighty river that flows from heaven into the temple and out to a hurried and dying world. Nothing can stand against the river. As it washes away every fear and every doubt. James tells us to submit ourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. But we must first submit our life to God. You can resist him all you want, but if you don't submit your life to God, you can't do nothing with it. Then and only then can you be victorious. Peter tells us, be sober-minded, be watchful, for your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Sober-minded means someone who is serious and sensitive.
Yes.
To be watchful, someone who always is observing and watching someone or something, being alert and being vigilant. Someone who studies their enemies and their ways and is always looking out for his attack. Corinthians says, lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. We are not ignorant because of the Spirit of the living God. Church, Church, we are soldiers in a war between good and evil, between light and darkness. God chose us for this position, and not we ourselves. Did you hear what I said? God chose me, and He chose you. And if He chose us, He equipped us for the task.
Amen.
He saw something in us that we didn't see in ourselves. We are a blessed people. The Word of God tells us in John, "Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go forth and bring forth fruit and that your fruit should remain." What we do for the Lord is expected to last forever. Timothy tells us, "Therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that wars entangles himself with the affairs of this life, and he may please him who has chosen him to be a servant." So be careful about getting caught up in the things of this life. Don't get caught up in the routine of everyday life. Yes, we live in this world, but we are not of this world. We don't isolate ourselves from this world, but we must insulate ourselves from this world and keep ourselves unspotted and free of the vile affections and the lust of life. Above all things, guard your heart, for out of it are the issues of life. The Word of God tells us that no man can enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he first bind the strong man, and then he can spoil his house. Luke says it this way, "When a strong man armed keepeth his palace, his goods are at peace. But when a strong man, then he shall come upon him and overcome him. He taketh from him all of his honor, wherewith he trusteth and divides his spoils." The strong man we're talking about here, that's Satan. But the stronger than the strong man is God.
Yes, amen.
Can't you get see? Can't you get understand that God is fighting for us? He's pushing back every darkness in our lives if we allow Him, if we obey Him. All we have to do is believe, submit, and obey His word. For our God is a consuming fire, and none can stand before our King. But I'm going to leave you with this. Revelation 19. "And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he did judge and made war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood. And his name was called the Word of God." This book, you see, it just don't contain the Word of God. This is the Word of God.
Amen.
This book is alive.
Amen.
You don't believe me? This is the living Christ.
That's right.
Because it says, "And the Word was made flesh."
Yes.
"And dwelt among
us."
I tell you, follow it.
Amen.
Live it.
Yes.
Embrace it.
Yes.
Breathe it in. Love it. Stand with it, and it will stand with you.
Amen.
I want to be able to echo Paul's voice. He said, "I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me on that day. And not to me only, but to all that love his appearing." Church, trust God.
Yes, amen.
Trust his word. Stand firm in his promises. He said, "I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you." And that's what he meant. He says, "Come and follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." That wasn't just for the apostles. That's for everyone ever sitting in this room. So what am I saying here? Every one of us has gifts and talents. But God is not going to develop those for you.
That's right.
You're going to have to develop those for yourself.
Amen.
God is not going to leave you alone. He'll help you. He'll encourage you. He'll stretch you. He will put you in places that you really don't want
to
be. But it's always for your edifying, for your good and all. but that's how you become mighty warrior. You go through the trials of life.
Come on.
You go through the heartaches, and he builds your character.
Yes, amen.
To serve him and to live for him.